So 3D mice, the way I think about them, are tools that we use the same way we use bicycles. Instead of walking somewhere, you can bike somewhere, and you can go a lot faster by biking. Now, the downside is you have to learn how to ride the bike in order to be able to ride it in the first place. But once you do, you save so much time traveling. And the same thing is true for 3D mice. I have here two different 3D mice. I have the compact and I also have the professional edition. I want to talk a little bit about why I use one over the other and which one you should get depending on your needs. So I'll say right off the bat that if you're doing below 3 hours a week of CAD, you probably don't need a 3D mouse. If you're doing between 5 and 10 hours of CAD a week, then you might want to consider buying, say, the compact. This little device with two programmable buttons is going to be a good middle ground and make it easier to just flow through the CAD world and have a little bit more control than having to click around the screen. This, the professional edition, as you can see, it has all these buttons, kind of like bells and whistles. So we're going to cover what the functions of these buttons are. If you're doing between, let's say between 15 and 40 hours a week of CAD, then you'll definitely want to spring for either the professional edition or the enterprise edition. So we're going to talk a little bit about the Enterprise Edition, but we're mostly going to be covering these two because this is what most CAD users are going to go for. Let's do an example using this 3D model that I have on screen of an assembly. So I'm going to place my hand on the puck and I'm going to rotate it left. And I'm also going to try now rotating it right. So I can push it all the way until it stops and it rotates at its fastest speed. And I can also control the speed of the rotation by coming to the 3D mouse settings and setting the speed higher. So you can see that. And it updates immediately. So this is much faster, a little bit too fast. We're going to dial it down. Let's try pitching it forward. I'm going to slowly rotate it forward. You could see that forward movement, and it's going to tumble forward. Same thing if I roll it back. It's going to roll back towards me. We can do the same thing left and right. And there's the right. And we can also choose to just push it forward with it still facing up. So if I just push this whole thing forward, it's going to start to move away from us. If I pull it back, it's going to come towards us. And if I push it left and I push it right, then the model will move left and right. There's also another axis that's maybe not thought of as much, which is to just pull. So if I just pull up on this, the model will pan up. And if I push down, it's going to pan down. Let's start with the right side of the hand. So I'm going to press here where it says fit, and you're going to see that it moves the model to the middle of the screen. Let's try this button that says F. So that's going to rotate it, and now it's hanging upside down. We're looking at the front, so this is the front button. And let's hit R, and that's going to bring it to the right side. And if we click on this button, you're going to see that it locks the rotation. So it's not letting me rotate the puck. See that? I'm rotating it and it's just panning. And I click it again and all of a sudden we can rotate again. It really feels like the buttons in your car almost, these things. So I'm going to click this one and I can rotate the model around. So the view cube is rotating by a full face at a time. And if I hit T, if I hit this button, it's going to show me the top of the model.
And you'll actually notice that when you hit these buttons, like if you hit front, it only shows you the front. It's not like you can hit it and it goes to the back. It's not like you can hit right and hit it a second time and it goes left. So it's only showing that one side. There are also four other buttons that we do have to touch on, and these are function buttons. So you can see that I just clicked this one, and I don't have these set right now, but this one opened up the screw command. This one is opening the mate. So that's pretty useful if you wanna make one and two extrusion and revolve, and you wanna make three and four different mating options, like a revolute mate for three and a slider mate for four, whatever you're used to using. And on the other side here, you can see we just have the menu itself for all of those settings. And we just have a continuation of the keyboard, which is what we would use if we didn't have a 3D mouse. So let's look at some of the advanced settings that we have. I'm gonna click on advanced settings. And with all of these selected, I can go and change the speed of individual directions of the six-axis puck. So I can have, say, the left and right a different speed than the forward and backwards. I can also turn the LEDs on and off. Kind of a preference thing if you ask me. Now, here's an important thing to note. If you buy one of these and you put it on your desk, you plug it in, and you see that when you're not touching it and that your model is rotating a little bit, that means that you need to calibrate it. You need to calibrate your 3D mouse. So you just need to click on this and you don't have to do anything. It does it all on its own. You just have to not touch the puck as it's calibrating and it will calibrate itself and you won't have that issue anymore. We'll come here to buttons. We can make this, say, a 3D connection setting only. We can make it so that when you press down, you decrease the speed or you increase the speed if you're still getting used to the speed of the 3D mouse. We can make it open applications. So you can make, say, number one, the button, when you click on it, boom, SolidWorks opens. Onshape, you know, a browser opens. You got Onshape, you Fusion 360, whichever software you're using. We also have the keyboard. So again, if you're trying to replace your keyboard because you used to use it with your left hand and now you're changing to a 3D mouse, then you might want to have one of these as a button, or you might want to have just a macro or a mouse setting itself. And we have these same similar options for the menu button and the fit button. And you can, in fact, change any of them. So all of the things that we covered are really the default, but I think it's important to keep these buttons the same. I mean, if the button says T, you probably would want it to go to a top view. Just makes it easier. And so that is pretty much it. We can export our settings. So if we move to a different computer, we can use those settings. If you have issues with connecting, what I've found in the past is that sometimes it likes to have the software running when you open it. To touch on the enterprise version, the biggest difference really are the 12 programmable buttons that you can see, and each one links to a color box of that function. So if you click on one, for example, you can look in that colored box on the LCD screen for one, and that's the function that you have set for that button. So you have basically 12 more buttons that you can use for all different tasks. The reason I would not recommend the Compact over the Pro is because it rotates around on its own a lot and it's really annoying. I think it's worth it to get the professional version because it's just a more solid feel when you use it. In conclusion, I would say that you'll be happy whether you go with the Pro or the Compact, but I think that the Pro is just a better built product with extra buttons that I think are very much useful. And so today in 2024, I would say that it's worth it for most people over the Compact.